Bible, which clearly says that anyone after the Bible teaching, after Jesus teaching a gospel other than what he taught, is a curse. Don't listen to him. But just reason alone. Just thinking about comparing people in the past who said they were prophets, biblical prophets who performed miracles, all sorts of things, Jesus who rose from the dead, who raised the dead, and then you come to Muhammad and Joseph Smith. What does Muhammad bring better than Joseph Smith? Let's take the next caller right now. Welcome, you're on the air with Jesus or Muhammad.
Peace of Christ to you guys. Thank you for this program.
Thank you, brother.
This is a Christian with you.
Yes, thanks so much for calling.
You know, I want to answer first Dr. Battle. Supposedly he spoke about smart and not smart. And I wonder why he's lying to us. He thinks because you guys don't speak Arabic. He said that the jizya, it is the tax for the army. When it is the fact, it says, Wahum Sahirun, which means you pay it with humiliation.
Right.
So why, Dr. Battle, you are lying to people? Isn't it a shame for you to be a doctor and to be a liar? If you go to Ibn Kathir, it says, you know, because it's a sign of disgrace and humiliation. Secondly, we go to Manu, who always play games. He speaks for an hour, but he say nothing. He says, by the way, yeah, honestly, this is how they are. You know, honestly, first of all, it's not fair to compare between the false prophet of the Mormon and the false prophet of Islam, because at least the false prophet of the Mormon, he was not a child molester, he was not a caravan rider, and he was not a killer. So we have to give him some credit. We cannot compare him to Muhammad in any way except that he is far the same as he is. But still, he is a lot better than Muhammad. In the same time, Manu, or whatever after him, they say, let us see how good Muhammad is. He said that everybody said that Muhammad is good. Let me show him from the beginning how Muhammad was a false man. When Muhammad did marry Khadija, if you go to the book of At-Tariqat al-Kubra and you read it from page number 10 to page number 25, you will see that Khadija and Muhammad, they did made a plan to make her father drunk. And they make him drunk, and they color his beard with henna. Henna, simply in the old days when they have a wedding, they color the hair of the beard, so they are which like they are celebrating. So they made him drunk, they drunk him, and then they colored his beard. And then when he woke up in the morning, he found Muhammad in the house, in her room. He told her, what he's doing here? She said, you married me to him yesterday. So she did, if he's a good man, he should not know to do that. He started his marriage by a lie. Secondly, if he's a good man, he should not marry a woman for her money. And all of us, we knew that Arab people will never marry a woman older than them by 1 year, what about 25 years? So Muhammad was not a good man because always he seek money, he seek power. He was poor, she is rich. In the top of that, when we speak about Muhammad, he saw an angel. What is the proof that Muhammad he saw an angel? If you go to the book of Sirat ibn Hisham, page number 239, you will see that first time Muhammad he saw something, he came to his wife Khadija and he told her, "I see something, but I'm not sure what it is." So she told him, "My cousin, next time you see him, let me know." So when she saw him, when he saw that thing in the second time, he told her. So she ordered him to sit in the top of her left leg, and she asked him, "Do you see him?" He said, "Yes." Then she asked him to move to the other leg, to sit in the top of it, and she asked him, "Do you see him?" He said, "Yes." Then she took off her clothes, and she asked him to sit in the position of sex, and she asked him, "Do you see him?" He said, "No." She said, "Glory to Allah, this is an angel." So what kind of a proof would this prove? I never heard about a woman, she had to make her husband sit in the top of her in a position of making love to prove to him that this is an angel. And the funny, Muhammad, he said, if you hear a rooster screaming, it means he saw an angel. And if you see a donkey, it means he saw a shaitan, which means a rooster, he had more skills from the prophet himself, because the rooster right away, he will scream when he see an angel. But Muhammad, when he saw the angel, first time the angel squeezed him, Muhammad could not recognize if this is an angel or not. Until she took him to Waraqa ibn Nawfal, and she told him the story. And then Waraqa, he said, it is Waraqa who said, not Muhammad. He said, "Oh, this is must be the angel which came to Musa. His name is Jibreel," which is funny. The angel came to Muhammad. He spoke to Muhammad. He taught Muhammad, but never taught Muhammad until now. Who is he? Which is telling us that this is all is a lie. Now, regarding the name Jibreel, this is another lie from Muhammad. Because the name Jibreel means the mighty of God or the power of God, which is Jibreel. This is the angel of the God Eel, the God of the Hebrew. Muhammad, he stole the name from the Torah without knowing that this is not a name. This is a sentence, I was going to say it's a title or a meaning. It's not just a name. He took it as it is, and he put it in his book. If you go to the book of At-Tabari and you read the explanation of the word Israel, you will see it says Israel is the man of God. Israel, it means the man of God. Israel is the man, Abdullah, the slave of Allah, and Eel is God, is Allah. So even the scholars of Islam, they knew that Eel is God, and Muhammad, he took it. Now, if Eel is the God of Islam, why is not part of the 99 names of Allah? You notice in here that all the names of the angels in Islam, they end with Eel, which means that this is the most important name for their God, which is false. It's not their God. This is our Lord. And you will see that Jibreel and Mikael saying clearly that we are the angel of Eel, the God of Hebrew. So Muhammad, he took the names, he put them in his book, and he claimed that those are the angels who came to him. But the fact, they are the angels of Eel, and their names tell the truth. So in every way, in every mean, we can see that. And on the top of that, if we go and see how many times the Muslims, they say to Muhammad that you are telling us fairy tale stories. As an example, they say to him, Asatir al-Awwaleen. You will see that in chapter 6, verse number 25, chapter 8, verse number 31, chapter 16, verse 24, chapter 23, verse number 86, chapter 25, verse number 5, 27, verse 68, 46, 17, 68, 15, 83, 13. More than 9 times, they said to him, this is the fairy tale stories from old days, what you are telling us. So they said to him, you are a liar from the beginning. And actually, they called him 6 times that to be crazy in the Quran. And then a Muslim will come to us, you know what? Why none of the people at that time, they said to Muhammad, you are a liar? Actually, even they accused him that he didn't have a private part. So imagine how low things was bad. And if Muhammad was good, why the Quran defended Muhammad when he was accused by the Muslims that he did steal an underwear? I never heard about a prophet of God being accused that he stole an underwear except Muhammad. And the funny, the guy who said the Quran is complete and Islam is complete, you know what? The Quran is complete. Allah did not forget to make a verse to defend Muhammad stealing an underwear, but he forget to make a chapter in the Quran. Why chapter? To teach the Muslim how to pray. If you go to chapter 3, verse number 161, say clearly, وَمَا كَانَ لِنَبِيٍّ أَنْ يَغُلْ. The prophet is not a thief. You go and read the explanation. You choose the one you like, Jalalain, Ibn Abbas, whatever you like. You will see it's about a red piece of clothes, which is an underwear. Was accused that he stole it from the money they stole it from the pagans. They attacked the pagans. But imagine how low they are. They go, they attack people, they kill them, and they take their clothes. I never heard about people, they do such a thing. Like not even the gold, not only the animals, not only the jewelry, even their underwear, even their shoes. Like if you go to the book of Al-Bidayah wa Nihayah of Ibn Kathir, it says clearly, the prophet, he took a black donkey after killing the Jew of Bani Qurayza and 4 sandals and bunch of gold. So what kind of a prophet he would steal sandals? What kind of a prophet would steal an underwear? And they say to us, Muhammad must be a prophet of God. If we go and we speak more about details of the Quran, we will see the Quran does not fit in any way, in any mean. They say to you, make one verse in the Quran like it. You know what? There is many people made, and actually I have a recording, I can play it, but I know I'm not going to take the time more. I want to answer those people. The Quran is full of mistakes, grammar mistakes, history mistakes, science mistakes, social mistakes, all kinds of mistakes. Actually, the Quran itself is a mistake. There's nothing.
And by the way, let me just interrupt you for a second and remind our viewers, the Quran